All right, let's continue this little mini series that I started a little while ago. This one here is going to focus on how to animate the background image and also animate the foreground and actually create the foreground in the first place. If you recall, we had a portion of that, what looks like a portion of this, plastered in the foreground in the low fifth or tenth of the image. And so here's a couple of ways I would do that. Perhaps if you use the magic wand as a selection tool, what you can do is you can start selecting, but it's going to give you very few small areas, so you need to increase the tolerance perhaps to 10 or 20. That's already too much, so let's give it a little bit less. There you go. And no, perhaps even less than that. Let's give it about 10 or so. Alright, so it doesn't really matter too much, but we can do the shift, we can use a shift key to add to that selection. So I'm going to select a few areas here until I'm pretty much done selecting the bottom part that's kind of in the foreground, closest to the camera. The reason I'm not doing that simply with the lasso, I mean, I could go with something like this here and kind of give it, you know, something somewhat semi-random. The thing is, I want it to pick some of the structure that's already there, and especially the shapes, because those will be nice shapes to keep also in the foreground. Albeit, I might flatten it, I might make it a little bit thinner, but it's good to have something that looks somewhat similar, either by way of the nature of these rocks. I don't know, it just looks fairly decent, so I'm going to use that magic wand technique. Again, perhaps a little bit less. There you go. And we could also go with the anti-aliased mode, but it's not really critical at this point. So I'll use this. Let's go to the bottom and then grab with the shift key perhaps a few more until we have pretty much everything. Now, we're not going to get everything. There may be some bright spots or dark spots that it doesn't get into with the magic wand. So what you could do is perhaps fill them in with the... Let me try one more time here. Right, so we have some areas that are selected, but not enough, and there are some parts we don't want selected. So here's how we'll do that. We'll use right-click to remove from the selection, again, with the shift key down, right? And left-click to add to the selection. And then at some point, if we, for instance, watch this through the overlay alpha mode, you see the pink area highlighted is the one that's not selected. And the true or original color is showing here where it's selected. But when you zoom in, you can see there are some parts with some heavy amount of marching ants around it. And those we need to actually select too. We don't want to have holes remaining through there. So for that, I'm going to simply use the paint tools, such as a large brush. But then I'm going to force it under the selection menu to paint on alpha. And that's here somewhere there, paint on alpha. So whatever brush I'm using, I'm actually going to apply to the alpha channel here at this point. Left button will make it black, right button will make it white, and white will be the selected side of it all. So I can go with the right button here and fill in over those small areas where there's some specks of black points, and therefore make sure that they are all fully opaque, fully selected. And perhaps I can use some smaller brushes, or I can go close to that, zoom in a little bit. Remember how you zoom in with the control shift and then with the right button? So left hand I have over the control and the shift key, and right hand I have the mouse, and I'm using the right button to zoom in, and also the right button right now to paint in. With the right button I'm painting to white, because that's what you see down here on the left side. My primary color is black, my secondary color, the one that's used with the right button, is white. And so I'm able to easily fill in those things to black without branching out too far. There are a couple of other ways that you can paint on alpha. Let me finish this right now. I'm painting on alpha, so I'm going to delete that and go back to regular. So we see we've cleaned up much of it already here, and one thing I want to do is finish this part. The other technique would be to actually use one of the preset brushes, and it's down here, paint on alpha. So with that one you can go, let's say a hard mode or soft mode, Let's use the hard mode, and you can have the preview, because that one's actually a custom brush, so it's going to show in the preview. And again, you can right click. Now that one's painting on alpha directly, so it's a slightly different approach. You need to use the left button here, the left mouse button for this one. But again, it's not modifying the colors, it's modifying the alpha selection mask here. And once we have done that, maybe we can fix these a little bit here too. Doesn't have to be perfect. What we're gonna do is we're gonna flatten this anyway, so it's okay if it branches up pretty high. But before we do that, let's give it a little bit more saturation. Remember, this is gonna be the stuff that we want to see in the foreground. So we want to see it brighter, we want to see it also more saturated. And so the thing to do is perhaps while we have that selection in effect, first of all, select store that alpha channel, because you might need to go back to that. And then go to the filter menu and see if we can add some color or saturation. There's something like hue saturation value. Yeah, that one could be useful. Now, these are fairly grayish tints already, so it's not going to do a whole lot. But we can perhaps change the hue and then add some value, and especially the saturation. We could also give it a little bit of embossing to give it even more of a 3D look to it. We're going to see some granular detail. So let's do two more filters. One is the embossed, that would be under the convolution filters, convolve. So there's a gray emboss and a color emboss. And the color emboss already can get you pretty good results for additional texture or additional depth to it, right? Because we're supposed to see more detail since this is supposed to be up close. Another technique, let me undo this. Another technique that could be useful is actually to stylize it with an actual light source. And the elevation of these pixels, the brightness of these pixels will indicate the elevation. So I can go and perhaps simulate like the presence of a light source somewhere and to make it pretty bright, increase the original color as well, flatten it or expose it some more or extrude it some more, change the smoothness so that perhaps there are not too many details showing. But I think I really want to have a lot of grain and details there. And so let's keep it with this. Let's perhaps add a little bit more specular highlight and change the distance of the light source as well. So we want to have sort of an even lighting, so it appears to be coming from the sun way up in the sky and not just from little spotlight somebody's carrying around nearby. So that's good. We could change the color of the light. You know, if we're going to put a bluish light sun in the background eventually, it might be good to actually change the color of this light to kind of reflect that way as well. Now that's too much. Let's give it a little bit less of that blue. And there you go. And again, we could perhaps make it brighter, make closer, that sort of thing. All right, so we have now whatever the colors are that you like. Let's stay with this, why not? What we want to do is pick this up and animate that in front of the original image. So we have the selection, we can easily pick this up, perhaps store it first. We can store this image, because we might need to get back to that as well at some point. So we have the original here, and then this is what we modified it to. And let's get rid of the alpha channel. Actually, no, let's not do that. Let's also pick it up as a brush. So what I'm saying is that whenever you have a selection in effect, like a mask showing here that shows some pixels are selected, whether you show them by way of the alpha overlay or you don't, and you still have the marching ants, but even if you disable that, you still have that selection in effect. You didn't clear it. You're just not showing the marching ants right now. So if you have a selection in effect, what you can do is you can pick this area up directly as a custom brush image. And then we can actually animate that. We can have it go across the frame sequence of the animation from left to right, for instance. And so one way to do that is under the brush tool and just say whatever is selected, pick that up as a brush, right? Use selected as brush, and Control B would be the shortcut. If you have the preview enabled, you'll immediately see this as a preview. Now, we don't want it that high. We want it a little bit flatter. And we want it also wider than the image, because we'll be passing this image from left to right. We'll be moving it slowly. When we want this as the foreground to move even faster. So first thing I'll do is I'll store this brush that I just picked up, because again, we need to manage it and do some things to it, change its color, perhaps some more, change its hue. You could do that here. There's a hue saturation value. So let's go perhaps, you know, maybe there was too much blue here. Maybe we want still some rock or desert colors, and that would be better. So let's store that one now. And that way we have one that we can use. Actually, that one had it stored in here as we made the change. But if we reset this, I think if we restore it, no, it does actually go back to this. Yeah, so that's the modified hue. But what was restored is the scale, in case we change the scale to really small and then we restore it, it goes back to the original size. All right, so what we could do now is to flatten it a little bit, and that's that means we don't want to scale it uniformly. We want to scale it in a non-uniform way. So let's pick the brush and go to the brush tool, to the brush menu, and scale it. That's a resample. And in the resample, you'll have the option to constrain it or not to constrain it. So the original image is showing a width of 1600 pixels. That's how wide the portion is that we picked up, and how high. It's about 225 exactly. And so what we could do is we change the size here, but that will change it uniformly, or keeping the aspect ratio, right? So we're constraining it to keep the aspect ratio. We don't want that. We want to flatten it. So what I'll do is I'll say unconstrain it, remove this checkbox, and then simply make it smaller in the Y axis and perhaps even wider in the other axis. Let's say from 1600 we'll go to 2000. So now we have a very flat and wide floor that we can put on the ground. And so how are we going to animate that? First of all, let's store this again. That's another brush image state that we want to keep. Maybe we don't need the old one anymore. We can always try to recover that, since we have the original alpha channel mask still. So this is the one we're working with now, and what we'll do is we'll need to have it animate from here across, right? So perhaps if we reduce the step here to very small, and we're not painting in alpha anymore, we don't want that, so let me reset it. Actually, one way to reset it is simply choose another brush that's not painting in alpha. And then that way you're now painting in regular, but we still have that alpha channel that I just placed there accidentally. So let's just clear that, clear alpha, and also restore the original image. There you go, click on that stored thumbnail, and now my brush is going to go, let's make sure it's in fully opaque mode, so opacity 100%. So now I can have that brush in the foreground. Now it's currently already wider than the image, so I have a little bit of margin. I can have it go from left to right without seeing the end of it. And if I needed more of that, I could still just increase the size of it. Where do we do this animation, by the way? That's in the tool called the brush keyframer. Now before we do that, we want really the background to also have an animation. Right now the background is just a static image, so let me temporarily disable the preview here so it doesn't get in the way, and understand that we have here an image, a single image. The image info here shows us 1600 by 800, and what we want to do is turn this into an animation where this entire scene is going to go from the right to the left very slowly. So one thing we can do is first of all create an animation from that static image. And let's say we want 120 frames, or maybe more. Let's give it 200 this time. And it gives us an estimate of how much memory we need. I don't know that that's going to be a limit here or a problem. Maybe the math wasn't right as it was showing here. Let me check on that. Let's keep in mind this is still a beta version. Roughly 109 megabytes needed. Oh, this is how much free memory I have. 12,000 megabytes. Yeah, 12 gigabytes. I have a 16 megabyte system here, so plenty of memory left. It's even though it's running as a 32-bit app, I'm not sure that I'm going to be able to allocate all that memory. But 109 megabyte definitely is not a problem. Let's go to 200 frames, 732 megabytes, still no problem at all. So let's go and allocate that. And we do have now an animation, but each frame is exactly identical. We just got a copy of that original. So what I'll need to do is actually shift this image sideways, and the way to do that is in the timeline. Well, it's not the only place, but this is a good place to do it. So what I'll do is I'll grab this image that I currently have in the entire image sequence here. I'm going to apply a transform filter to it. And that transform filter, of course, is called, well, simply transform. I don't want to shift it, because if I shifted it, the left edge will wrap around and come back on the right edge, as you can see here, right? So that's not the solution. The solution is to transform it and actually shift it sideways. Now, there's something else that's happening, is that we see the edge of it, the end of it, right? So what we need to do is actually make the image bigger than our view, our port view that we have here. So what you could do is you can scale it. You can scale it up pretty high, actually. You can scale it up to 2 times its original size. And so you only see half of it right now, which means you have the other half waiting to be seen by scrolling through it. So that's the technique I'm going to use here in this case. I'm going to position it so that I'm not seeing the bottom. I'm going to go down a little bit. There you go. I'm not seeing the left edge, just barely, like so. And maybe even down more, so I see a little bit more of the sky. And that will be a keyframe I store here on the left side. So I have a keyframe, and I can, by the way, again, if you need more detail and more granularity on what you're seeing and what you're working on, just resize this window. But what we can do now is we can go to the very end of the animation and simply change the horizontal. Right? We don't want it to move up or down or anything. We just want to change the horizontal. So we're on 92 initially here. We're going to go to negative 92. If we go too far, there you go. It's reaching, as you can see here, it's reaching the edge. So let's go to just about this much, minus 98. It's probably at exactly 100 that they will be reaching that. So we'll set the keyframe on that end. And the thing is, we want that to go in a sort of a linear fashion. Now, by default, it's a smooth acceleration, and then it kind of slows down again. So it's a spline interpolation. For instance, if I had some other positions in between, it might go, I don't know, something like this. If I keyframe that, you might see, oh, that's a bad example. Let's say, for instance, something like this. Let's keyframe that. Yeah, you see some changes, but then it slows down and it comes back up. So these are spline interpolations, and we don't want that. So this icon here indicates that we're currently using a spline interpolation. When you unclick that, uncheck that, it's a straight linear interpolation. That's really what I want in this case. I also don't want this keyframe, so I'll just remove that. This keyframe here is good. Actually, no, this one's not good either. We don't need this one. We just need one at the beginning and that one at the very end. And so at this point, we see only, by the way, the positive values in this preview here. So that might be a glitch, or that's just the way it's been. But what's important is that we can actually now see that we are seeing an animation in this preview here, where it's going to move along the horizontal from left to right. By it transforming the image from right to left, what we see is as if we have the camera moving from left to right. All right, if we're confident, we don't need to save undos, but I still remember keeping it there and then apply. And so as it's applying that, it's now transforming the image that it sees in the current frame and scaling it up and transforming it a little bit, like shifting it sideways, and then it moves on to the next frame and does the same thing again and again. So we now have an animation which is a little bit zoomed in, but we have more to look at, and we can now have this animation go from right to left. And so that's a slow animation, and we want now another animation to go also even faster. This one's actually pretty fast already. Maybe we didn't need to make it go that fast, but that's okay. We can adjust it next time. What I'd like to do now is to go back to that stored image that I had, the stored brush, and this brush image, I want to put it in front to even move even faster, right? Because we really want to simulate as if we have the camera going from left to right, and everything that's close to the camera is going to move even faster. So what I'll do is I'll choose that brush, and I'll make it go in through the brush keyframer now. And the brush keyframer will show the current brush right there. And in fact, that's also an image you can resample. I mean, you can change the size so it matches a little bit more the aspect ratio that you know your image has really underneath it. And then you could go and see here how much you can already transform. However, I think we need more. So I'm going to rescale it some more. I can scale it like this. And then I can go to Yeah, so that's already a little bit too much, so maybe I'm going to need to scale this down so I have more leeway on that brush. Then now I can reach the edge, and I'm going to go like so. This one, that's the first frame, keyframe that. Then I'm gonna go to the last frame. You see the background is moving now here on this one, and I want the brush to move even faster, and so it's going to be a longer move. I need to reposition my window so I can actually move my cursor all the way to the left edge here and make sure that we have that over here. So that's for the last frame, and keyframe that. So there too, we don't want a spline interpolated or smooth transition. We want the linear, so click on linear on this one. And now we are going to render that. Let's just see what it looks like as we do that. Oh, before that, let's preview it. Yep, sure enough, the foreground is moving a little bit faster than the background. Right, and of course that's because we made it so. That's not automatic, that's because we made it transform a bigger image than the one that's in the background, and we made it go from left to right just the same. But it's moving faster, and it could go even faster than that if you wanted to, but let's not be too picky about it. Let's go and render that. So where is the render button? Down here somewhere. Oh, there it is. Yeah, render that. So now it's rendering the custom brush across the entire animation sequence. Now that's not the only way that you can do something like this, but it's a fairly convenient way if you can think outside the box, if you can think through the brush, right? So instead of thinking through multiple layers, think about taking that image into the brush that you want to move and that you want to animate, and then make it so by going to the brush keyframer and indicate where you want that brush to go through. And then once it's done, it takes a little while, it doesn't update everything here when it has a lot of frames to render. Disable the preview, and you're pretty much done with this animation. So let's go and take a look at it. And there you go. So we can imagine this, maybe using this for a game, right, where we have the background. Maybe we could have blurred the background a little bit even more. Maybe we could have the background darker or mistier or whatever you want to do, atmospheric effects. It's already kind of misty with that foggy look there, so that's basically making it less necessary to add the additional pizzazz, like you know, something like blur or motion blur or distance blur, right? So we can get away without it, but it would have been nice to add that if we wanted it absolutely perfect. Still, I wanted to really focus on just how do we actually move this thing in the foreground. Well, you can render it across the background at a different motion speed, at a different movement.